Nowadays, meditation has become a very popular religious subject all over the world, especially in the West. They never conduct any religious service without meditation. So they concentrate more on meditation. When you read certain Buddhist stories, Dhammapada and many other stories, you can see many of those meditators could manage to attain either jhana or sainthood, sotapanna, sakadagami, anagami, arahant, within few days time. But today, although we meditate for many years, day and night, by attending various meditation courses, why we cannot gain anything? What have you achieved so far through your meditation? If you did not gain anything, what is the cost? People have different mentalities or beliefs or objects or intentions when they want to meditate. They want to gain many things. Good health, to get rid of their sicknesses, long life, to get rid of their problems and worries and disturbances, and for their business to make more money, for their security, various purposes. The main purpose of meditation, as introduced by the Buddha, is something else. But on the way, when we meditate, we gain or we experience many of those worldly or material things come across on the way. But we have to go through, we have to forget these gaining. If you stop our meditation after gaining certain material things, again we come back to the same place where we were. Satipatthana Sutta, the most important, very popular discourse, Sati Upatthana, Satipatthana, the way of mindfulness. In that sutra, you might have read what the Buddha said. Ekayano ayam bhikkhave maggo. There is only one way, one method for people to practice. What? Sattanam visuddhiya. For the purifications of the mind. Soka pariddhavanam samatikkamaya. To get rid of the existing worries and miseries and mental disturbances. Dukkha domanasthanam atthagamaya. To forget our existing unsatisfactoriness in our life or suffering and lamentation. or imagination. Jnāyasya adhigamāya. To attain the highest stages beyond this worldly or mundane life, such as sotāpanna, sakadāgāmi, anāgāmi, arahanta, higher stages, supramundane. Nibbānasya sacchikiriya. To attain the final liberation or salvation. Why it is called liberation or salvation? Other religions always use the word salvation. We use the word liberation. Same meaning, but the concept differs. Every religion accepts without any controversy that this existing life or this world creates suffering. Otherwise, there is no reason for them to use the word salvation. If there is any religion in this world to tell us, there is no suffering here in this world, we can enjoy our life, and then they cannot use this word salvation. Salvation of what? Since every living being, humans or non-humans, experience either physically or mentally some sort of unsatisfactoriness, unhappiness, disappointment, and pain. They are praying, worshipping, and doing something to get rid of all those existing unpleasant, unhappy situations. So, others believe there is a place where they can live without facing these problems. That is heaven to them. They say heaven is the only place where there are no suffering, no death, no sicknesses, no old age, eternal. Therefore, they use the word salvation. Here the Buddha used the word Nibbānasya sacchikiriyāya. Nibbāna, Nirvāna. Nirvāna, the end of craving, meaning of Nirvāna. Now there you can understand where suffering exists. Where there is craving, my dear friend, there is suffering. Remember it. No one can deny it. If you crave for something, whether you gain this or not, definitely, if not immediately, you had to face lot of problems and difficulties and worries and unsatisfactoriness, unhappiness, disappointment because of that craving. If you have not developed that craving in your mind, you never experience those problems. That is what the Buddha said. Define this word, Nirvana. No more craving for anything. If we crave for anything, then we must be prepared to face the consequences, forms of suffering. Now that is called end of suffering. That is called liberation. That is called salvation from the Buddhist point of view. So my question is, although we meditate, sometimes we glorify We meditate and meditate and meditate, create our own imagination, thinking that we have gained something, but we do not know what we gain. In our Buddhist book, it is mentioned, there are 10 Pali Bodha. Pali Bodha is a Pali word, impediments. Impediments means hindrances. For us to achieve, to gain anything through our meditation. 10. In Visuddhi Magga, the book, Path of Purification, you can find these 10 impediments, obstructions for our mental development. Avaso cha kulang labho gano pachyanti mang pichya. The first item is avasa. Is there any Malay word called avasa? No, avasa. Avasa means a dwelling place, the meaning of the word. Dwelling place means house. If our mind is attached to any building, any house, if we are responsible for that house, if we maintain that this is our house, my house, that feeling create enormous disturbances in our mind. You cannot say no. How many things are there for you to attend, to protect, to look after, to maintain, to beautify, to decorate your house? By devoting your time, all the while thinking of your house, you experience the difficulty of maintaining peace in your mind through your meditation. Your attachment. Now you are here. You came here to listen to this sound. But in your subconscious mind, you can see, you are thinking, what is happening in my house? If there is nobody at home, whether thieves have entered into my house, that is called impediment or hindrance for your meditation. Whether monks or laymen, makes no difference. The Buddha's advice to the monks, they can stay in any beautiful house. There is no restriction that monks should not stay in beautiful house in the Buddha's teaching. Whether it is a mud house, mud hut, or a mansion, beautiful palace, you should not develop your attachment and craving towards that building. But you can use this as your shelter, that's all. A monk who stays in a mud hut, crave for that house, oh, this is my house, this is my property. The one who stay in a palace, he used this as a shelter, but he never developed craving for that house. This monk never disturbed his mind for his meditation, but the monk who stay in the jungle or in the hut disturbed his mind. Understand this. So, those who really want to meditate, if they want to gain some sort of achievement, or development in their mind, they had to reduce their responsibilities and commitments and craving towards their houses. So how many people are there to do this, who can do this? You can meditate throughout your life you won't gain anything. Anything means real achievement through meditation. That is why renunciation is important. Without renunciation, while maintaining all our responsibilities and commitments, although we meditate, we never, never reach the final goal. But the time that you spend for your meditation can calm your mind. You can relax. Very good for your physical body, your brain and brain cells and nervous system, blood circulation, your heart and organs and glands. Very good. That is why you feel some sort of nice feeling after your meditation. Because during that period you do not create excitement to disturb your mind. Disturb. You never disturb the mind at that time. And you are not crazy for indulgence through your senses during that period. Mind is calm. But how long can you maintain this? Your meditation is like this. I can give a simple example, then you can understand. You can take a big vessel and cover certain area of our compound, the grass, green grass, you can cover. And keep this for 1 or 2 weeks. After 2 weeks, you take out this, you can see green grass turn into white grass. You have seen this, isn't it? Now everybody knows this. Now, turn into white grass. So the time that you spend for your meditation is exactly that period. How you change your mind and mental attitude is exactly like green grass turned into white grass. After a few days' time, again you go and see it, the white color change into green color, normal color. So when you come back after your meditation, again your commitment and responsibilities and the worries and anger and jealousy and grudge and craving again flows. That is why you cannot gain anything. I can give another example. Assume there is a nice pond or well where you can find very clear water. But this water is covered with dry leaves or grass, completely covered. So when you want to take one bucket of water from this well or this pond, you can dip and shake here and there, then you can see nice crystal clear water. Take one bucket from there. The water is very clear. Immediately the same dry leaves or grass cover the water. So the time that you devote for your meditation, what you do at that time, you remove the dark clouds from your mind, dirty ideas, wicked ideas, silly ideas, you remove for the time being. Then the mind becomes very clear, only for a short while. Just like the bucket of water that you collected from the earth. When you stop this meditation, again the dust and rubbish come and occupy the mind. Then how can you gain the highest achievement through your meditation? So one of the impediment or responsibilities or disturbance which hinder our meditation is our responsibilities, commitment, attachment towards our property, houses. You cannot say no. Second one, I have no time to explain all these things in detail. Second one is kula. Kula means family. Attachment towards certain family, particular family. This advice is given specially for the monks, those who meditate. Now we have, I think, not less than 10,000 members and devotees who visit this temple as followers, as our friends, as our devotees. If we develop our personal attachment towards one particular family, thinking they are our good friends, then we develop attachment. And this attachment hinders our spiritual development, our meditation. Therefore, a monk should not say, this family or these people are my devotees. It is wrong. We must have same feeling, whether they are rich or poor, whether they are Chinese or Sinhalese or Indian. All are human beings. Without any discrimination, we must fulfill our duties, religious obligations. So if we develop personal attachment towards one particular family, that attachment hinders the spiritual development. This is the second impediment for our spiritual development, to experience good results through our meditation. Third one, gain. This is the most dangerous thing. When you read Majjhima Nikaya Sutra Pitaka, it's a very interesting information. One day, Sariputta, the chief disciple of the Buddha, suggested early part of the Buddha. The behavior of certain monks nowadays is not very healthy, he said. Therefore, time has come for you to introduce a disciplinary court for these monks. Sariputta suggested. Because at that time, Buddha has not introduced a disciplinary court, only a simple or general advice for them to behave, that's all. Then, so what did the Buddha say? He said, time has not yet come, it's still early. Then he has given few reasons. First thing, the number of monks, disciples, are still very few. Second reason, their knowledge about worldly material things, or philosophy or psychology or science, is still not very deep. Remember it, they are knowledge. And they are gain, the gift that they receive from the devotees, are still very, very few, very little. When these things increase, then we experience the difficulty of controlling the Sangha, the monks, or the disciples. So the Buddha did not accept Sariputta's advice to introduce disciplinary court at that time, because the Buddha could satisfy with their way of life. Knowledge can disturb faith, devotion, confidence in religion. A person can become skeptic. Then they do not respect, they never listen to anybody because of their knowledge. That is what the Buddha says. So that knowledge is not the important thing for a religious life. That knowledge can disturb our spiritual way of life. When there are many, say, few hundred thousand in one group, we experience the difficulty of controlling them. When they are a few, it is easy to control them. That is what the Buddha says. When they receive more and more gifts from the devotees, they also develop their craving and craving and craving. The more you give, the more they develop their craving. You spoil them. By knowing this, the danger of this, your duty is to provide requisite what they really need. This is called requisite. If you go beyond this, you support them to develop their craving. That is why in certain temples we have seen how monks and monks fight to become the chief, to occupy the temple. The reason is red packet, red packet, more and more red packet. If you don't give this red packet, they never fight. That is the way how you increase. But when you come to know that we need your support, either to buy some medicines or the books or anything requisite, then it is your duty to go and support them. But don't spoil them simply by distributing every time you come, red packet, red packet, red packet, you spoil them. What is happening in many other temples all over the country? You increase their craving. Here, the Buddha's advice is, if we gain more and more profit or gift, we experience the difficulty of controlling our mind to maintain peace, then how to develop our meditation? Now, this is the third one. Next one, a group of devotees or members or students or disciples. If the meditator is responsible for this group, this will become another mental hindrance. Because he has to attend to them, look after them, and he is responsible for them. And there may be lots of problems, controversies, arguments, different characters and behavior and temperament, and he experiences difficulty of controlling them, then he may lose his temper, he scold them, shout at them. Then this will become a big problem for him to meditate. Therefore, when a meditation master or anybody who meditates associates with another group very closely, he should not take responsibility, burden of this particular group, whether students or devotees or members. But he must fulfill his duty towards them without taking such responsibility into his mind. We have experienced all these problems when we want to control our disciples, our students, our members, our devotees. We lose our temper. We cannot control our own mind. Circumstances, because there are thousands and one commitments. I had this experience. When you started to erect all these buildings, school buildings, pagodas, and the monks' quarters, and these buildings, how many times we had arguments, heated arguments, misunderstanding and jealousy because of these projects. And every time all these issues disturb the peace in our mind. So a meditator should not get involved directly, should not take the responsibility of any project, but there are many things that he can do without involving too much, without disturbing his mind, by maintaining peace. Otherwise, difficult to gain anything through meditation. Next one, if a meditator starts to travel from place to place, there are some people who travel from this temple to another temple, that temple to another temple, from this country to another country, that country to another country, searching a good meditation. They believe that they can find out a meditation there, outside. Those people cannot understand. We cannot gain anything from outside for our meditation. Wherever we go, we carry our own mind. By using this mind, we practice here or there, this meditation, there is no difference. Of course, environment, circumstances, situations, climate, they are congenial for a meditator. That is a different issue. But you might have heard that story. Somebody asked this question. How can we find the most contented, happy person in this world? In which country? Which part of the world? Then the answer was given in this way. If you sit down here, calm your senses, concentrate on one particular object, the most happiest and contented man we can find here. Not necessary for you to go anywhere in searching a happy, contented man. It is in your mind. So traveling from country to country, temple to temple, either for religious activities, or meditation, or some other purpose, can disturb the environment, disturb the mind and the body. Circumstances are on the way also disturb the mind. And the climate also disturb the mind. And people around that area also disturb the mind. So, traveling from place to place for meditation is a hindrance for meditation, according to the Buddha. Therefore, we cannot gain any extraordinary development in our mind by visiting from place to place, country to country. If you really know how to meditate, you can do it here. Even temple also not very important, if your house is congenial, suitable. Your mind is the only important thing for your meditation. The next one is relatives. Assume we have so many relatives. Almost every day they come and disturb us, asking this and that, and they want to get loan, they want to get money, they want to borrow something, they want to take away something from your house, and they come and complain, they come and grumble, and they, what you call, there are differences and grievances and problems and so many things then you have no peace because of your relatives. And some of those relatives also are very cunning people. They try to take advantage of you, to gain something from you, disturb your mind, bluff you, swindle you, because of your relationship. So if you have no relatives, so much the better for your meditation. Do you know, a young boy who has renounced his house and life, the family, and to become a novice monk, and gone to another village, and after spending for a few years, he came back to the same village where his family, father and mother and all the others are staying. Every day he goes out for begging Pindapata, his arms round, and he visits this house also, his own house. Many years he has visited this house. And his father and mother and family members could not recognize him, and he also did not indicate anything that he come from the same house. He visited this house as a stranger. That means he has no attachment towards. That is called renunciation. It does not mean that when once a person renounces a family, he must ignore or forget the whole family members. No. Take, for example, the Buddha. After his renunciation, how he come back? He had to return to fulfill his duty towards his father, stepmother, his former wife, his child, his brothers, and everybody. But he did not develop any attachment towards them. So this particular monk did not indicate anything for them to know that he belonged to the same family unless he attained the higher stage, sainthood. Now, attachments automatically eradicated no more. After that, introduce himself. Because now no more attachment. Cannot develop attachment. There is another story in Dhammapada. An old nun had only one son before her becoming a nun. And that young son also became a novice monk. One day, when the monk was visiting somewhere, a novice monk happened to meet the mother. The mother talked to him. He ignored. He did not answer, and he did not want to listen to this old lady, what she said. Just went out. Then she started to grumble, look at this young boy, he's my own son. He doesn't want to talk to me when I ask something. Complain. And later, when he was asked why he behaved like this. What this young monk said, if I talk to her, then again we develop our feeling attachment. Then this can hinder my spiritual development and her spiritual development also. She developed her attachment, I develop my attachment. Best thing is to ignore this for the time being until we gain higher stage. After that, no more attachment, but we can fulfill our duties and responsibilities. Now, that is what these relatives and friends, attachment towards them, create a lot of commitment and responsibilities and disturbances. Try to reduce that attachment, of course, when your services are needed. Don't forget them. You cannot ignore them. We can fulfill our duties towards anybody without even developing our attachment. We can fulfill our duties toward our children without attachment. But how many can do that? Because parents need emotional satisfaction through their children. That is the most important thing for a father and mother. So while fulfilling their duties, they also develop this affection, attachment, to gain emotional satisfaction. It's not so easy to forget that. But even then, it is not impossible to do that. Fulfill all your duties without developing personal attachment or expecting anything in return. After that, you never experience disappointment. You never complain because you did not expect this. You have done your duty. Then easy for you to meditate. Next one, sicknesses. If we suffer from certain sicknesses, sicknesses can create frustration, unhappiness, and insecurity feeling, thinking that we are going to die, then fear. If mental attitude is such, then we experience the difficulty of controlling that mind to maintain peace. But if we are wise, we can take the sicknesses and the feeling as an object for our meditation. In Satipatthana Sutta, feeling, pleasant and unpleasant feeling that we experience, we can take as objects for our meditation. Then it will become very effective. Then we never create that frustrations or disappointment. We consider this as natural feeling without harboring hatred toward unpleasant feeling, without developing our affection toward the pleasant feeling. Avoid both. Regard these things as natural feeling. They are changeable. These feelings, pleasant, unpleasant, are not permanent. Then this will become meditation. But many of us create very, very bad atmosphere when we are sick. We grumble and cry and accuse and blame and behave very funny way, especially elderly people, very old people. That is, of course, age. Very hard to satisfy them. Very difficult to console them. Always grumble for everything. They have complaint. Almost every day they have complaint. Then how to meditate? So sicknesses create disturbances in our mind for us to achieve the development in our meditation. Next one, Gantha. Gantha means book. Book knowledge. You may read 110,000s of books to gain knowledge. You want to know how many stars are there in one galaxy. You read books, how many million. And you want to know how deep is this earth. You study and record. You want to know how far from this earth to this moon and sun. Record. Your knowledge is wonderful. So you go on developing and developing. You want to know how many energies, many kind of energies are there in atomic energies. Electron, neutron, proton, this ton, that ton, all sort of things. Your knowledge is wonderful. And you study so many languages. every religion. You study Buddhism, Christianity, Hinduism, Islam, Judaism, and everything. You study history, geography, biology, chemistry, anthropology, and what do you call astronomy, astrology. Wonderful knowledge. So when all these things get together, accumulated, it's a vast area in your mind. Your mind becomes roja. Now you cannot decide what is right, what is wrong, what to do and what not to do, whether this is right or whether this is wrong. You cannot understand because of vast knowledge. So that knowledge is not the important thing for a man to develop his mind, not through academic book knowledge, to develop his mind, to train his mind, to purify his mind, to find out the final salvation. So, don't read too much. And even Buddhism, when you read Buddhist book nowadays, I think you get fed up with Buddhism. Now, printing book has become another nuisance, actually speaking, real nuisance. They do not know what they print. They cannot understand what is in the book. People have written all sort of rubbish by collecting donation from the public. You can see how sometimes we have to collect certain books from there and burn because they are misleading innocent people. When you read these things, you cannot understand what is Buddhism. Again, you want to mix up all these, Theravada, Mahayana, Tantrayana, Vajrayana, then Japanese Buddhism, Korean Buddhism, and Tibetan Buddhism, and this Buddhism, that Buddhism, all mix up together. Then Buddha's teaching is not there. So reading all sort of books completely disturbs your faith and devotion and confidence in Buddhism. You can argue, you can talk. That's all. You can say, yes, I know what is Theravada Buddhism, I know Vajrayana, I know Tibetan Buddhism, I know Japanese Buddhism, I know this Buddhism, that Buddhism. But he doesn't know what the Buddha taught. So this book knowledge, I strongly advise you not to read all those rubbish what people published and distribute. A person who writes a book must consider very carefully. Who are the people? Let's read this book. What is their knowledge and understanding capacity and the language? They create more confusion and misunderstanding by publishing all these books. Especially the books written by Westerners. The way how they have distorted, misinterpreted the teachings of the Buddha, because they cannot understand the real concept, real idea what the Buddha taught. Because they know their own language, English language, they can write. They have completely misled people by writing, because they have no faith, no confidence. They don't believe what they write. Remember this. This is the nature of scholars. Scholars do not believe what they write. That is only theory. They want to show how clever they are, style of the language, and deep knowledge about this. But the readers get into trouble after reading all this. Therefore, when a person writes a book, he must know that he, without damaging the devotion, confidence of the people, must know how to present this subject to gain more knowledge and more confidence. Here, so what the Buddha said, don't depend on book. Earlier also he has given this advice. not to depend on your holy book. People can say, yeah, it is in our holy book. Therefore, we must accept. The Buddha said, don't accept just because it is in your holy book. People can write anything in their book and later introduce, oh, this is given by God, came down from heaven, introduced by Buddha, but their own opinion, ideas. Those books which were written, say, about 800 years after the Buddha, by various scholars, after introducing so many things what the Buddha has rejected earlier, again they have incorporated and introduced this subject as Buddhism. What they say? They say these books were written during the Buddha's time. There was no such writing system to write any Buddhist book at that time. They cannot understand it. See how stupid they are. Even Vedas, Hinduism, older than Buddhism, they never had any book at that time. They also have recorded all their books many hundred years after the Buddha, even Hindus. They say during the Buddha's time, they have written all those secret doctrine. They say secret. The Buddha say, I have no secret, I have revealed everything. But they say secret doctrine. Hidden in Nagaloka, underground work. That means Buddha had underground work also. This is the way how they try to introduce Buddhism as very powerful, dynamic religion, Buddhism, secret religion. And later they discovered this. See how they mislead innocent people, talking rubbish. That is why I strongly advise you, when you are going to read any book, please find out what this book is. Otherwise you get into trouble. You lose confidence in Buddhism. And many of those who have attained sainthood during the Buddha's time, I think they have not studied even ABCD. They do not know how to read and how to write. But they had devotion, confidence, and their minds are pure. They have no dirty mind. What we need is pure, healthy mind. Devotions and confidence. You can forget your books. You can meditate with pure mind by reducing these 10 kind of impediments, responsibilities, commitments which hinder our spiritual development. Last one is very peculiar thing. Iddhi. Do you know the meaning of iddhi or riddhi? Iddhi, Pali language, riddhi, Sanskrit. The miraculous power. You are crazy for gaining miraculous power. The purpose of your meditation also to gain this miraculous power. But you do not know this miraculous power hinders your spiritual development. You miss the target if you stop your meditation after gaining some sort of miraculous power. What sort of miraculous power? Especially through jhana meditation or samatha meditation, some people gain, after fourth jhana, they gain some sort of supernormal or psychic power. Without eradicating their craving, anger, jealousy, or the defilement from their mind, they develop only mental energy through this meditation. Now you can see the difference. The mental impurities still remain just like sediments, although they are not active. So they develop their mental energy through their meditation and gain this jhanic power, miraculous power, supernormal power. Before Buddhism come into existence, many people have done this, especially in India. They can appear and disappear through this psychic power. They can fly like a bird in the sky. They can walk on the water. They can read others' minds. All these are the development of psychic power in the mind. So if you stop your meditation after gaining any of these psychic power, you had it. What will happen? You can misuse and abuse this jhanic power for your personal worldly material gain. Again you drop, completely drop. What happened to Devadatta, who developed this, who gained this jhanic power, miraculous power, appeared and disappeared and transformed himself into various forms? Such a man, he is suffering in hell today. He abused this miraculous power. That is what the Buddha says. Iddhi or riddhi or jhanic power or miraculous power can hinder your spiritual development because you can abuse and misuse. So you have to go further. These are the 10 kinds of mental disturbances which interrupt our spiritual development through meditation. So, some of them that I mentioned, you had to fulfill as your commitment. But you must know how to handle them. Without developing too much emotional attachment. You know the difference between attachment and emotional attachment. Attachment with understanding is not dangerous. Attachment through emotion without clear understanding is very dangerous. That is why people commit suicide when certain things happen. Emotion. If you develop this attachment with understanding, we know how to stand firmly. That's very important. Especially husbands and wives, parents and children. They can develop this with understanding. If they use only emotional feeling and affection, then they get into trouble when certain misfortunes take place, happen. Okay.